Their Pangea was a band started in Santa Clarita in 2008, lead singer and guitarist being William Keegan, bass player being Danny Bankston, and drummer being Eric Jimenez. Today we're gonna see how this lo-fi bedroom project came up and how they would be a highly respected alternative surf rock group through the years. This is Together Pangea, a history. Pangea was originally formed around 2006, created by William Keegan and his girlfriend Adrian Tunney at the time. Adrian was from Toronto, Canada, and William was really inspired by her dad because he was working in the music industry at the time. They both started recording music in his bedroom in Santa Clarita, California, on his 4-track. They recorded a lot of songs, and supposedly there was about 40, and they probably will never see the light of day. William eventually dropped out of high school to pursue music full time. Around this time, he was also making money by working at Six Flags Magic Mountain. His parents weren't too happy that he dropped out of high school, but he still received his GED later on. One of the first bands that Adrian was in was called God Equals Genocide. It was a hardcore punk band, and that's where she met future Pangea member Danny Bankston. They would even play festivals sometimes, like Awesome Fest in North Park. They were signed to a label called Razor Cake. Danny was originally from Van Nuys and then moved to Santa Clarita around middle school. He attended Hart High School, but then he eventually got kicked out. He was homeschooled for a little bit, and then he finally graduated from a charter school called Bowman. Around this time, Danny was also making money by working at Pickup Sticks. Danny and William first met at Java Junction in Newhall at one of the first Pangea shows. Danny was playing in a band called Venus Diode. It was his high school band, and it was also another hardcore punk band. They kind of sounded like a mixture of the Blood Brothers and the Faint. He was actually the lead singer in the band, and when they performed, he wore tight pink shorts, and he used to go by the name Danny Heat. He seemed kind of like an emo scene kid back in high school with these pictures you're looking at right now. So at Java Junction, William was playing in a show with them in the middle of a parking lot. Danny went up to William after the show and told him that he really liked his music, but William kind of just blew him off. And later that night, he got drunk with William's brother in the dumpsters. But later on, William and Danny eventually started to become friends, and they would start a group called Grisnar, which was a few friends, including Adrian, and they would play around the town, but it was only acoustic sets. They even played in a sewage drain in the ocean by San Pedro in 2006. They have a lot of songs online still, and one of the most popular ones has to be Golden Arches, and it's about McDonald's. And their MySpace page is still up, so you could check out the photos on there, and I'm pretty sure you can find some old songs on Tumblr. When they eventually started playing together in Pangea, Danny actually was the guitarist, and they had a few other members come in. Their keyboardist was Bavane Salvandria, sorry if I butchered that. And then they also had Thomas Vertigo, who played guitar and keyboard from like 2007 to 2011. And Danny would slowly transition to playing bass. They released 3 Pangea albums that not a lot of people know of, and I honestly couldn't find it on Google, so if you know where this is, put it in the comment section below. One of their first albums was called Wisdom Surf, and their second one, A Burden of Pillows, and their last one was called Magic. After Danny graduated high school, he started attending CalArts, pursuing a degree in fine arts. Once he finally graduated, he received a bachelor's degree in fine arts, and I'm pretty sure that's one of the hardest art degrees to get. CalArts was where the majority of the first Pangea shows were played. Adrian would eventually leave the band to pursue other things. She graduated CalArts, and she would pursue being an artist and gardener, but she wouldn't stop doing music. She started a solo project called Badlands, which was inspired by desert landscapes, so they obviously needed a new drummer, so they had a few tryouts. Eric Jimenez was one of the drummers that tried out, and he played this song, Rumbling Sound, which would be off their LP Jelly Jam, and they thought he played it perfectly, so they wanted him immediately. While in high school, Eric was in a ska punk band called Five Finger Discount, which was about 7 to 8 members, and Eric dropped out of Saugus High School his sophomore year, but he would also receive his GED. In high school, Eric actually had a job at Taco Bell, and the first Pangea show they all played together at was a bar in Little Tokyo called Second Street Jazz, and they played with a band called Bad Vibration. fans, and the bar is no longer there. Their real first LP was released on July 24th of 2010, and it was called Jelly Jam. They released the album off the label Lost Sound Tapes, which was located in Seattle, and it was only released on cassettes. The album was very interesting, I would say. Most of the vocals were fuzz, there was a keyboard in it, and it all kind of just sounded awkward, but really good at the same time. My favorite songs off that album have to be I Wrote a Bible, You Sleep Too Much, and Blood, Blood, Blood. You can only find this on Bandcamp and YouTube. It's not really anywhere else. Corey Hansen would join the band, and Zanny met Corey while attending CalArts. Their mutual friend, Miguel Cronin, kind of introduced them to each other, and he was in a band called Charlie and the Moonhearts at the time, and I'll get back to that later on. Eric actually played a show one time with Miguel Cronin's band, so they would keep playing backyard shows and parties and at CalArts, and then eventually they would release another LP. On September 21st of 2011, they released the album Living Dummy. This is the album that really got the ball rolling, and they really wanted to be signed to Burger Records. They were really into the audacity at the time. Danny gave the CD to his friend Matt, hoping that Sean Boram, the owner of Burger Records, would get his hands on it and be able to listen to it. So eventually he was able to listen to it, and he really loved it, and he emailed them, and they were able to release the record off Burger Records. William is the one who thought of the name Living Dummy. The album was written in Newhall, at William's old house, and the album just kind of wraps around partying, since they frequently did that all the time because they were playing party shows at CalArts. The song Summertime is a folk song, and it's about going to the river with a girl in the summer. I know the chords are not the same at all, but it kind of reminds me of the song Beach Porn, at least the way it was recorded, and listen to the drums in the chorus. Tell me that's not almost the same exact drums in Beach Porn. Night of the Living Dummy is one of the most popular songs on the album, and it's one of William's favorite ones he's recorded. And it seems like he's talking about a girl in this, and questioning if everything's his fault, with some of the lyrics being, "We don't hold hands anymore, we just give head anymore, I always wanted to try, is it really my fault?" In the song Shitty, it kind of seems like he's talking about a girl, because what I'm hearing from it, he's screaming at the top of his lungs saying, "Bitch, she's a bitch." That could be wrong because it is very fuzzy, but that's what it kind of sounds like to me. The song Too Drunk to Come was also one of the most popular songs on the album, and it was written to be a relatable song, and they were paying homage to their punk brethren, the Dead Kennedys, with their song called Being Too Drunk to Fuck. When they first started to play shows, they said they weren't really the greatest. They didn't really tune their guitars that well, and they just kind of went for it. Their first real tour was around 2010 to 11 with the band called Mean Jeans. One time when they were playing at the Observatory, Ryan Adams saw them play, so he tweeted at them after the show, saying that he wants to record some music with them, and they were pretty psyched that he wanted to. So they went in the studio with him and recorded about 5 songs or so, and it didn't really work out. They said that he was a little too controlling, but he meant well. But he also introduced him to people at Harvest Records. In 2012, they released an EP called Killer Dreams, which featured the songs Killer Dreams, Love and Alcohol, Plasma, and River. And River would actually be on the next album, Battle Act. They released 2 singles before releasing their second LP, Battle Act. And this was their last release under the name Pangea. They released a single called Snake Dog and a single called Offer. And Offer would be on Battle Act. They said Snake Dog was their least favorite song they ever recorded. But honestly, I think it's really good. When they were about to sign contracts to Harvest Records, they made them change the name because there were so many Pangea names out there, and they didn't want to get sued. So they changed their name to Together Pangea because that was their MySpace page already. But during concerts, they still referred to themselves as Pangea. They didn't really like their name, but they thought it was too late to change it. And I think they were pretty salty about it because you could barely see the word Together because it was so small and hidden, but it looked like it just said Pangea. And I think they got away with it because it did say Together in the album cover. Look at the difference between these 2 album covers. I think this was the album cover before all the lawyers came in and said, "Y'all need to change your name." Their second LP, Battle Act, came out January 1st of 2014 off Harvest Records. The producer of this album was their longtime friend Andrew Schubert, and it was recorded in Ghostbot Studios in Los Angeles. Andrew was working at the record studio at the time, and they would wait for his boss to leave, and then they would record from 10 p.m. to 7 a.m. They recorded 3 sessions in the span of a year. They started off with about 30 songs for Battle Act, and half of them were bubblegum punk rock, and the others were a lot darker, and the darker ones seemed to make the album. The album had the same vibe as Living Dummy with the punk songs and the fast music. The production on this album was so much cleaner than on Living Dummy. They actually recorded it in a real studio. Living Dummy was a stepping stone for Pangea. We knew what they were capable of, but they just needed a better production value, and that's what we got with Battle Act. They recorded an album that old fans would love, but it would bring in a lot of new fans as well. Their influences for this album was definitely Nirvana and any punk band really in the 90s. I feel like also Black Flag as well. Songs like Alive and Depressed, even Catman reminds me of the song Rat's Eyes. Just the way William screams in the songs kind of remind me of Henry Rollins. They named the album Battle Act because they thought it sounded cool. It doesn't really have any meaning behind it. The album has a dark and depressing vibe to it. The album revolves around relationships and trust issues. Danny just got out of a long-term relationship, and William finally cut things off of Adrian. The song, like Does He Even Care, seems like it's coming from a kid's perspective, and he's looking at his mom's significant other, and he's just kind of saying, does he really care about you? Is he looking at all kinds of girls using you to get him by? And then at the end, he's like, Mom, I'm just gonna wait outside. That song's kinda really dark and fucked up, but great at the same time. They also might have taken some influence from Green Day's album Dookie. The song In the End has a similar meaning to it. William even said one time, one of the first songs he learned on guitar was When I Come Around by Green Day, and Danny's first song was Brain Stew. Remember the song River off of Killer Dreams, how I was talking about? Well, they re-released it on Battle Act, and it seems like he's saying, you spend so many days being productive, so why not spend a day just getting fucked up and drinking beer with your friends? The river is always running, but then there's you, not doing shit, and you're just stuck in a rut. The song Offer was about getting talked down to and dealing with trust issues and losing best friends, which could mean losing a partner in a relationship. The song Sick Shit is one of the most popular songs on the album, and he's talking about being lazy and unmotivated and not really attracted to anything when he's saying, my dick is soft. It's just a cry for help. Throughout the album, they kind of slow things down a little bit near the end with songs like Why and No Way Out and Where the Night Ends. If you wait till the end of Where the Night Ends and wait till 4:42, they play a hidden track called Drop Dead City. It's actually really amazing, so go check it out. Penelope Gazin was the one who did the artwork for Battle Act, and I'm pretty sure she did the same artwork for Living Dummy. Danny met her while attending CalArts, and he thought she was pretty cool. After Battle Act, Corey left the band to pursue different things. They had a few different guitarists like Chad Upovich and Matthew Zook, but they didn't really last that long. So they eventually landed upon Roland Cosio. They met Roland because he was playing in the band Charlie and the Moonhearts, and they used to play shows together back in CalArts. And Danny saw him at a show and talked to him, and Roland was down to play with them. So that's how they kind of got together. Later in 2014, they embarked on a European tour. At first, the touring was kind of bad, William said. He was drunk 80% of the time, and one time he played 4 songs and then started climbing up the rafters. Danny was the one in the group who had it the worst. He was addicted to alcohol and doing drugs. Before I dive deeper into Danny's drug and alcohol problem, I just wanted to say this is coming straight from the horse's mouth. I messaged him and we talked over email. This was one of the questions I asked. I wasn't trying to be pushy because I know this is a very personal topic and like some people don't want to talk about it, but to open up to all the fans and tell them about it is amazing, and I think you're a great musician and I really respect you. So Danny said he always had drug and alcohol problems. He tried coke when he was only 14 years old, and he even dabbled in heroin a little bit. The song that Zach Carper wrote from Fiddler, the unreleased one called Aluminum, was about Danny and Zach shooting up heroin together. He said he finally sobered up after playing a show with Twin Peaks, Swimmers, and Waves at the Telegram Ballroom in LA. After the show, he said he went home and blacked out on coke, Xanax, and alcohol. He said he even microwaved his phone, and then it blew up in the microwave, and he finally came to after that. He said he took the rest of his Xanax and he sent scary messages to his friends and family, just kinda saying goodbye. His friend Killian from the band No Parents responded to one of his messages. He was at the Twin Peaks Airbnb, and he called Danny an Uber and was just trying to calm him down. Danny took some Adderall to kinda even out, and then he ended up at their place and drank until the sun came up. In the morning, all of his friends woke up to his concerning text messages, and they all tried calling him right away. But remember, his phone exploded, so all the calls went to voicemail, and all his friends just expected the worst. William went driving around and half expected to find Danny just dead on the sidewalk. The guys from Twin Peaks dropped him off a little bit later that afternoon at William's house. He walked in just like nothing happened at all and he just started drinking a beer right away. His friends were really fucking pissed, but really sad at the same time. They had an intervention for him later, and he went to rehab 2 days later. The rehab facilitation he went to was called Cry Help in North Hollywood, and he went for about a month, and the doctor said he destroyed 60% of his liver, and if he didn't come to rehab, he would have been dead within a year. He said he was able to bring his iPod with him, and he listened to a lot of Neil Young, and this is where he wrote some songs that would be on the next album, Bulls and Roosters. I'll get into that a little bit later. Right after he got out of rehab, he went straight on tour to support their EP, The Phage. After a year being sober, he tried drinking, and it lasted about 6 months. He said it was the worst decision he's ever made. He will have reached 3 years of sobriety in March of 2020. On October 16th of 2015, they released an EP called The Phage, which was named after a Star Trek episode. But they aren't Trekkies at all, but they just thought it was a cool name. Sophia McMahon was the one who designed the album art for it. It was recorded in King Size Sound Labs in north of LA on April 22nd and 23rd of 2015. Some of the demos were also recorded in Golden Beat Studios. It was produced by Tommy Stinson from The Replacements. This was the first album that really got me into Together Pangea. I've heard of Battle Act before, but once they released this, I listened to it and I just fell in love with it, and it'll always kind of be my favorite Together Pangea EP, album, whatever you want to call it, just because it introduced me to them. You know, you always have that band that the first time you heard that song or the first time you heard that album and you loved it, and it's always going to be like your number one. Well, this is my number one for Together Pangea. It literally just reminds me of senior year high school, because that's when it came out in my senior year, and I just kind of listened to it nonstop. Anyway, getting back to the album, some of these songs were supposed to go on Battle Act, but they didn't think they fit really with it, so they released an EP for it. And honestly, it's great, because Battle Act and this are very, very similar, and it's kind of just an extended version of it. Like I was saying, they toured this album a lot. They would wait about 2 years before releasing anything new, and once they finally released new music, it was something that no one's ever heard before from them. It was a step in a different direction. Their new album, Bulls and Roosters, came out August 25th of 2017. Kelsey Reckling is the one who took the album cover photos, and she is also William's girlfriend. They started dating around 2013, and they met at CalArts. Kelsey was originally from Houston, Texas. She worked at a treatment center for rehab patients. She also records music under the name Reckling. It's on Spotify. She released her self-titled album. It's pretty fuzzy, but it's really cool, so check it out. Bulls and Roosters has a very twangy folk rock sound to it, and it was completely different. It wasn't really punk at all. But then again, they did have some faster songs like Sippy Cup and Better Find Out. They still have a twang folk sound to it, but that's similar Together Pangea sound that we've heard in the past. Sippy Cup was a great way to kick the album off, with trying out different sounds but having a similar taste of what their music used to be like. The song pertains to dealing with the struggles of adulthood, but has the metaphor of a sippy cup dealing with childhood. One of my favorite songs off the album, The Cold, was written on a 60s Fender Mustang, and it definitely has the most cowboy western feel to it. Honestly, it could fit anywhere in any western movie. Hope you guys enjoyed that. There was a lot of different guitar riffs and sounds into this, so they had to practice a lot with different things. Their lead guitarist, Roland, would take home some of the demos that they've recorded and try to find cool riffs to it. Kenmore Ave was one of the first songs that Danny wrote in rehab. It was about dealing with his struggles with alcohol and drugs and breaking up with someone just because they couldn't deal with it anymore. While Danny was in rehab and he was listening to a lot of Neil Young, it inspired him to write most of these songs with that kind of sound from it. A lot of these songs sound like Neil Young, Tom Petty, fuck it, even Fleetwood Mac, kind of. Money on It was the most popular song on the album, and it was pretty cool. They added a lot of different styles to it, and they had keys in the background of it. Better Find Out is probably the most similar track to anything else they've recorded in the past, with the intro being the amp fuzz being plugged into the guitar. Just like we've heard on almost every song from Battle Act, has that live feel to it. The song pertains around the struggles of being on tour and then being confined at home, how people shouldn't look forward for answers. Peach Mirror was literally a ripoff from their EP, The Phage, because one of the songs was called Blue Mirror and this one's called Peach Mirror, but it was really cool. They basically gave it a facelift and added synths to the background of it and made it still more twangy. I thought it was really good, and I don't really give a shit that they ripped it off. I thought it was great what they did. Southern Comfort is another song written by Danny, and it's not about the alcohol at all. It's about going down south and having a fling with a girl, you know, just la la la, normal like music shit, right? See, the thing is that Together Pangea somehow mastered with this album is they took shitty folk music, aka Tom Petty, Neil Young. Okay, stop getting fucking triggered. I just think that sucks. You know, they took that type of music and mixed it with their Together Pangea sound, and somehow it mixed fucking perfectly. I feel like with bands, when they release songs and music that sounds completely different, you either love it or hate it, and I think a majority of their audience loved this. And it's like, they probably didn't want to record another live punk record like Battle Act, and you know, I think they totally have the freedom to make something that completely sounds new. And you know, the band is just growing up and they want to try different things, so just let them do it. One of the last songs, Allison, gives me a 50s vibe to it. Not really folk as much, just 50s. Anyway, Danny wrote that one too, and honestly, that's probably one of my favorite songs on the album. He wrote it on a train going to Norway, and it's about an old crush that he knew when he was like in elementary school. They later would release some B-side singles to Bulls and Roosters called Misunderstood and Praise. Praise was also written by Danny, and again, it was about rehab and alcohol problems. The album was recorded in Golden Beat Studio with their good time producer, Andrew Schubert. The album came from John Baldessari's painting from the Broad Museum in Los Angeles. The painting was a manual for how artists should sell their work. The art piece argues that Bulls and Roosters sell better than cows and chickens. William is the one who saw the painting in the Broad Museum, and he thought it was kind of funny, so that's why he used it for the album. Later in 2017, they released on Spotify live songs from Autotree, and in 2018, they would release some acoustic sets of the songs, including a new one called My Heart. The album was under the name Sleeping Till Sunset. Roland would eventually leave the band near the end of 2017. He released a 7-inch through Burger Records called Moses and the Firstborn. They eventually had Matt Schmalfield join the band in 2017, and then eventually Patrick Nolan in 2018. I think they both switch off with touring because it still says they're both members of the band. So they would keep touring 2017, and the first time I saw them was at the El Rey Theater in September of 2017, and they were amazing. It was a great show. Later in 2017 and beginning of 2018, they went to Australia and they went on tour there with a band called Bleeding Knees Club. So they would keep touring, and then eventually at the end of 2018, on October 26th, they released an EP called Nonstop Paranoia. The EP starts with a song called Rats, and I wasn't really sure how this would turn out because I wasn't a huge fan of this song. And then with the next song, Hi-Fi Television, I thought that song was amazing. You can hear in William's voice that he's freaking out, full of anxiety and paranoia pretty much. It reminds me of Green Day's Jaded in Chicago they played in 1994, how Billy was freaking out on stage when he played She. It just kind of gives me that anxiety, crazy vibe to it in a sense. This is the song that really changed my mind about this album, because because all the songs after this are really good. The album revolves around anxiety, paranoia, and depression. Williams said he was diagnosed with depression when he was about 16 years old or so. They definitely took influence from 80s bands, that's for sure. Even at the end of the album, Gates of Steel was a cover of a Devo song. I guess they played it live one time and their friends kept telling him to record it. On the song Nonstop Paranoia, it reminds me of the Cars, at least the way the synths are played in the background. And then they would keep touring after that, and then they released another EP on May 31st of 2019. This was a completely new sound compared to their last EP. They definitely slowed things down. They said they took a lot of influence from 50s girl bands like the Ronettes, the Crystals, the Shangri-Las, and the Cookies. I know a lot of the old fans were kind of confused with this. They're like, what the hell is this, kind of? But if you really give it a second chance, it's really good. Bet You Wish I Would Call, Dispassionate, and Moonlight Lately was awesome, honestly. They even said that they just want to fuck around on EPs, and they're not really taking it seriously and just trying out different sounds. They recorded Nonstop Paranoia and Dispassionate at the same time. It was recorded in Balboa Studios. It was produced by their friend Danny Norgaris, and he's in a band called No Wind. Kelsey Reckling took the photo for Nonstop Paranoia, and she also sang some backing tracks on Dispassionate, and she worked on the album cover for Dispassionate, also with their friend Emily Kemp from the band Dead. I think I said that right. Max Keen from Fiddlar helped them out playing drums, and Killian from No Parents also played as well, and they had someone from their record label come in and play saxophone for them. They said they were gonna release these songs together as a full album, but they thought they just didn't really go together, so they just made them two separate EPs, which I think was a good idea. So it's almost the end of 2019, and Pangea is touring Europe at the moment, and I'm pretty sure they're gonna come back and tour the States in a little bit. They're gonna release new music soon, and it's probably gonna be a full LP since they just released two EPs. Alright, let's get into some fun facts about this band. They have a song called CIA, which is on Spotify, but it's under just the name Pangea, and I'm pretty sure that stands for California Institution of Arts. I could be wrong, though. While on tour one time, Eric made out with a homeless person, and for their music video Offer, that was recorded at Eric's 25th birthday party. Well, if you haven't noticed, really, Danny wears a grill in a lot of the performances, not as much anymore, but in the early days all the time. He said it was because he got in a lacrosse accident as a kid, and that must have fucking hurt. They have an unreleased song called All Creation. It was supposed to come out on the EP, I think, Snake Dog, but it never was released. It's on YouTube and it's awesome, so I suggest you go check it out. I'm pretty sure Williams said he was working at a hospital one time, caring for patients with cancer, and it was too much for him, so he couldn't do it anymore. In their free time, William likes to watch basketball, Danny likes to ride and work on motorcycles, and Eric likes to play basketball. Alright, so my top 5 favorite songs, and this is hard to choose from, just because they're all really good, but I tried to narrow it down, I guess. So my first 3 have to be Alive, Does He Really Care, and Offer, off their second LP, Battle Act. And my last 2 have to be off their third LP, Bulls and Roosters, and it has to be Better Find Out and Allison.